The year is 2018, and no, we still don't have flying cars. Here in this hotel, all the tokusatsu fans of these United States have been collected, and for a weekend they are thriving at a convention called G-Fest. Here we'll meet just one example of the many polite and welcoming people one can expect to find at...
No, I told you before. Now scram, get out of here. Oh, just beat a damn disembodied voice.
Perhaps we should have went to a different room.
Hey everybody, Brayton Connor here, and welcome back to the second installment of the G-Fest 25 experience. What you're going to be hearing today is an audio commentary track on Destroy All Monsters that Patrick, Andrew, and I recorded at the G-Fest convention to celebrate the film's 50th anniversary. We watched the English version on the Blu-ray, so if you'd like to watch it along with us, pause your film at 0 seconds in and press play in 3, 2, 1, play. Okay, and we are up and rolling. The old familiar Toho logo. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Only one, not two, like in Shin Godzilla.
Yeah, I'm sure we remember the good old days when we used to associate the Toho logo with quality entertainment and not crushing disappointments.
Yes. Or garbage.
Well, come on. But current events aside, Destroy All Monsters, based on a true story. But what is true is that this is the first of 6 unofficial last Godzilla movies, I guess, in the entire franchise, really.
Mm-hmm. There's a lot of events,
yeah.
I don't know if 6 is accurate, but there's quite a few, yeah.
Well, the Destroy All Monsters, Terror of Mechagodzilla, Mechagodzilla 2 was originally, Final Wars,
and GMK at one point was supposed to be the last film, well...
All the Millennium films are like in their own separate continuity, technically Tokyo SS is kind of like the end of its continuity too. Mm. So
yeah, true. Yeah, because I remember I was reading up on Gajewski's GMK book, and he mentions that originally they were going to end it with GMK as being part of a Hate's Millennium trilogy, and then they were just going to leave it off there. But I guess because of how much money that film made, they decided to continue it and do the Kiru duology.
Yeah, but this is definitely the first time that they seriously thought about ending the franchise.
Right.
Mm.
Yeah.
So when was the first time you guys saw this film?
But do you want to go first?
Sure. Destroy All Monsters I first saw pretty early on in my having become a Godzilla fan. I got the really old, really old DVD by, I can't remember the name of the company, but it was just the movie. Mm. There was no menu, there were no special features. It just put in the DVD, the movie plays, and when it stops, the movie just replays.
Did that come with the soundtrack?
This is the one that came before that.
Gotcha. Okay.
But it was that. And I saw that again pretty early on, so I was like in the early double digits of my life. It's like 10, 11, 12, somewhere around there.
The early double digits. Now you're in your 60s, Brad.
Right, exactly. As far as opinions go, I've always enjoyed the film. It's never been one of my absolute favorites, but I enjoyed it as kind of a fit-on story, but, you know, kaiju action science fiction romp. Although I should say I have not watched it in by itself for a long, long time, for quite a few years. Mm. So I have no idea how I'm gonna and how, what I think of it today. We're gonna find out watching this commentary. So.
Yes.
And given the fact that I've changed my views on a lot of Godzilla films over the years, like a lot of the 90s films, I have no idea what I'm going to think of it. I might have the exact same opinion. I might like it more or less. We'll find out.
Yeah. Andrew?
Okay. I started out my history of Destroying Monsters with actually with remember the import Godzilla books from Japan where they have like images of like all the other Godzilla designs over the years. Like,
no.
Really? Like, okay, there were a couple of imports that I was able to get from my folks for Christmas or my birthday, and one of them had Destroy All Monsters in it, which was a Godzilla film that I had not seen before. And it wasn't until around, I think, middle school when I purchased a DVD copy, around $30, I believe, of the, I believe it was Media Blasters who did it, of the first Destroy All Monsters release that included both the English version and the Japanese version in two separate discs. Mm. And even as a kid when I first saw this, my initials were, yeah, that was good, wasn't great, but I enjoyed it. Mm-hmm. However, as time went by, I kind of forgot about it. Even though I still remember the monsters, I watched it definitely a lot less as time flew by. Until around, I want to say since around 2016, I was doing a binging of all, no, it was actually early 2017, my mistake, of doing a binging of all of the Showa era Godzilla films. And upon my recent viewing of it, it definitely went down over the years. And right now, I consider this one to be one of my least favorite Showa films and probably one of my least favorite entries in the series.
Hmm, really? Okay. Mm-hmm. Coming in with some controversy. Yep. The first time I saw this was a while back, and it was the copy that I guess it came out for some anniversary release. It has the image with all of them, I guess, behind the Diet building.
Yeah,
the sort of weird Photoshop green mist job.
Yeah, that's the one I'm thinking of.
Yeah, but it came with the soundtrack.
It was ADV that put that DVD, those DVDs out.
ADV,
oh,
okay.
Yeah,
yours is the exact same DVD that I have, just with the soundtrack added as a bonus.
Oh, okay, then.
Okay.
Yeah, and I remember listening to that soundtrack in particular a lot over and over again, and that really gave me an appreciation for the music of the Godzilla series, mm-hmm. because it has a lot of Ifukube's best hits, I guess, within the soundtrack, but... I don't want to say overrated on what my opinion is, because the term overrated is in and of itself overrated.
Yeah.
But I guess it kind of is in that I think there's a lot put behind the, oh, we're getting all the monsters together, it's going to be our grand finale. Mm-hmm. And I think you spend a little too much time with the characters we're going to meet here soon, a little too mm-hmm. much time with the SY3, but we'll get there.
Mm.
So that's where my opinion on it currently stands. We just talked over the Kaiju Roll Call, which is pretty famous. Mm-hmm. And
really good sequence.
Oh, yeah. It's a nice way to introduce the monsters.
Very beautifully photographed.
Mm-hmm.
Also, I should also just say this for the guy. Rest in peace, Flipper. Getting killed by Rodan.
Yeah. You know, this is really kind of a sick and twisted thing. I want to know... what are they planning to just to research them there and contain them there?
That's pretty much the idea, yeah.
So it's kind of like just a research zoo facility that they're
keeping from ravaging civilization all over again.
But did they go freely and willingly, Patrick?
Obviously not.
Did Tsuchiya go around with a big net and just wrangle them all up and throw them on an island?
Well, funny enough, like I was able to meet up with Steve Rifle and Patrick, and he actually mentioned, you know, if anything with Destroy All Monsters, I would love to see a prequel of Destroy All Monsters where they explain how they captured every single one of the monsters. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And I too would be equally as interested.
At least they get free dolphin, though. Free fish.
Yes.
That's nice.
Which, funny enough, is, you know, that's something that Honda had wanted to explore more with this film. When he and Takeshi Kimura... Actually, we should probably start off with like a little bit of the background of this film before we get into like the finer details
sure.
of things. As we mentioned before, this was at the time clearly meant to be the final film in the Godzilla franchise. At this point, the genre was rapidly losing audiences. It was getting much smaller, much more narrow. Basically, King Kong vs. Godzilla hit the peak, and it was kind of like descending ever since. Previously, Son of Godzilla had come out. That only sold like maybe 2.5 or 2.4 million tickets. King Kong Escapes had come out and wasn't even anywhere near in like the top top most successful films of that year. Gamera vs. Gauss came out, was not Gamera vs. Gauss came out, and so on and so forth. And so Toho kind of assumed maybe this genre has finally run out. We've run out of ideas. We've kind of petered it out. Maybe what we should do is just do a big closing sale of a film. You know, let's round up all the monsters. Let's put an exceptionally large budget into it, and let's make it a nice, big, expensive final hurrah for this genre, and send it off with a big bang. Mm-hmm. And so, obviously, Ishiro Honda, having basically pioneered in this genre along with Eiji Tsuburaya and Akira Fukube, was obviously the go-to guy for this kind of film. So they brought him in, excuse me, and he and screenwriter Takeshi Kimura, who had written films like The H-Man and The Demon Vapor and Frankenstein versus Baragon and War of the Gargantuas, but had never written a Godzilla film before. They were given just basically one instruction: show a lot of monsters. That's pretty much all they were told to do. And when they first set out to work on the script, they wrote it together. Earlier on in the film and during the narration, the narrator talks about how they were breeding. There was undersea farming. They were raising animals under the water to be the monsters. Mm-hmm. That was something that Honda actually had wanted to go much further into with this film. He wanted to go much more detail with that, showing more scenes, more underwater footage, like research complexes underwater. He wanted to show just how he wanted to really go further with that idea of undersea farming, of marine ranching, as he put it. Mm-hmm. But, you know, even though this film had an exceptionally large budget for a Japanese film, even a Japanese special effects film, the number of special effects set pieces that were being planned out and such, there simply was not room to do that. They didn't have enough money to do that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it's funny enough, you know, when you said earlier on that it was based on a true story, even though you said that ironically, you kind of were sort of onto the right.
I got something right, Patrick?
Sort
of. The one of the working titles for this film was Kaiju Chushingura. Kaiju mm-hmm. meaning giant monster, and Chushingura being a reference to the story of the legendary 47 Ronin, whose story has been made into many, many, many films, including one with Keanu Reeves a few years back.
Okay.
It was basically 47 samurai whose master was tricked into committing ritual suicide. And they set out to avenge him. They planned this huge invasion of the man's fortress. And one night, and they planned over a very long set of years. And they eventually, you know, stormed his facility, broke in, and killed and beheaded him. And so Kaiju Chushingura is kind of a reference to that. And also, the Kiloks, the aliens in the film, in Japanese, their name is Kilak, Kirak. Mm-hmm. And the villain in the Chushingura story was named Lord Kira. Mm. So that's actually a reference to them. So in a strange sort of way, this film does draw some inspiration from true events. Nothing like what happens in the film, of course, but there are some light references to Japanese history in this movie.
Nice.
And now we come to the part where we all know...
And everybody's confused by it this very day.
Yep. And as we learned from the panel, there is no clue whether Gorosaurus was replacing Baragon or
was he replacing Bugs Bunny?
Yes,
so that's
an even better question.
Yeah, that's a possibility.
Yeah, there doesn't seem to be really any concrete evidence as to why Gorosaurus appears here and why he has Baragon's roar. Mm. In the script, he's referenced by Baragon as he is, you know, right here. You know, that's not a dubbing mistake. That's actually in the Japanese text, in the Japanese script. Uh-huh. Now, why Baragon was not used, there's conflicting suggestions. Some say it was because the Baragon suit was on loan to Tsuburaya for the shooting of his TV shows. Some say the suit had just gone back from Tsuburaya and was in too bad a condition. And supposedly there was a story that the staff chose not to use Baragon because they were afraid that his ears would get caught in the set and make it difficult to shoot that. We learned that from the panel as well.
Right.
But, you know, looking at the... But it clearly was not a last-minute change because, according to Steve Reifel and Gachacheski, the storyboards, the rough layouts for the scene all very clearly show Gorosaurus. Mm-hmm. So I guess maybe it was just a dab of lazy screenwriting on the staff's part that they did not bothered, or maybe it was shot after the fact. I don't know for sure, but
probably, yeah.
But you know, for whatever reason, either they didn't have time or it was too late. They did not reshoot the scene to have him say, Gorosaurus instead of Baragon. And as for why they chose to use Baragon's roar instead of Gorosaurus's roar, who knows?
Yeah.
Mm.
It's a memorable entrance, though. You got to give it that.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. Oh, definitely.
Yeah. And the miniature work in that scene was really good, too.
Very good.
Didn't we also learn that there was supposedly going to be a stop motion?
Limited stop motion in the quote unquote Baragon sequence, but that was not used. I don't believe it was even shot. I think it was just thought about doing it, but never actually did it.
Yes. Now here we're getting introduced again after I guess the little brief Skype call to the Moonlight Oh, there's Kenji Sahara. Look at that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep.
This is his. I think I looked it up. This is his sixth Godzilla appearance.
Oh, nice.
And he also apparently raided Joel Robinson's wardrobe closet. But he looks great. He looks great. He's always great.
Oh yeah, I love Kenji Sahara.
And here is the introduction of the SY-3, which is a cool model, and I hope you all like it because you're going to be seeing a hell of a lot more of it throughout this film.
Oh yeah.
It's more of the star than Godzilla is.
Oh yes.
Oh yeah.
This movie should have been called "Hey, look at this cool model we built." Isn't it neat?
SY-3, the movie.
SY-3, the movie. But you know, in fairness, it is pretty cool.
Yeah.
And it's a real major plot point and plot device when it comes to I don't know, just oh
it's oh, guys. Oh no.
Okay. We've got Akira Kubo playing a sort of tough guy role as opposed to, say, Monster Zero and Son of Godzilla, where he was very much more of a comedic kind of performance.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I think he does a fine enough job.
Yeah.
As a leading character
just
in the movie.
The script doesn't really give him much to do.
Sure.
Yeah.
Besides be Mr. Tough Guy.
And I think that's a common complaint, and it's a complaint I have to a degree, is that in a movie called Destroy All Monsters, we spend so much time with this crew in particular. And the characters aren't necessarily three-dimensional or
remotely interesting.
Remotely interesting, you know. There's not a whole lot of motivation there. They're kind of two-dimensional and bland. But the performances are really the only thing to carry a scene.
Yeah,
the acting
is across the board pretty good.
Yeah,
oh, it's fine. Yeah,
it's good. It's
this is back in the day when Toho put a lot more. When Toho had much better actors under contract than they do today. That's something that's really stood out to me as I've gotten older, is just how much better the acting in the 50s and the 60s was compared to a lot of what's come since. Like a lot of the acting in the 90s films in particular I find to be truly bad these days.
Sure.
Something I never noticed when I was a kid, but nowadays, boy, does it really stand out.
Yeah, well, that's something, you know, I think can be said for even, you know, Western acting and just maybe acting in general. You know, you grow up, you go through different generations, and there's different generations of actors coming up and how they're taught, and I think it may just be a timely...
The problem is that back in these days, Toho actually trained their actors in their craft. That's how we got people like Takarada and Mizuno and Yumi Shirakawa and even Toshiro Mifune. They came out of a program called the New Face Program, in which they would recruit young actors and actually train them not only in acting but dancing and theatrical arts. And so they were very well versed in their craft. But that's all gone now. And mostly, starting with like the 90s and such, they mostly just grabbed actors from J-pop groups and television,
right,
where there's obviously not very much, you know, high training put into it.
Yeah. Some occasions, though, I have heard that they do bring in some people who at least worked on J-dramas, but even then, it's most of those, like, really, like, popular
ones.
And of course,
you do have very good actors who turn up in later Godzilla films on occasion. Of course you do. And some directors, like, say, Shusuke Kaneko, know how to bring out the best of actors, even if they're less experienced. But the studio has changed big time. Going back to our point, one good thing this film had going for it was that, you know, even though the script doesn't provide the actors much to do for the most part, the actors in and of themselves are well trained for the most part and are good enough in and of themselves to carry a lot to make up for it somewhat. And on top of that, Ishiro Honda was very much an actor's director, so to speak. You know, he cared very much about the quality of the performances. If I might say so, Honda was not really, as I've learned talking with Steve Rifle. Honda wasn't really much of a visual filmmaker like, say, Akira Kurosawa or Yasujiro Ozu.
Yeah.
He didn't really worry about, you know, the framing and the types of shots he used. He was more worried about, you know, the quality of the story, the script, the performances, the continuity and such. And he usually let the his cinematographers and his art directors worry about the look of his films. Mm-hmm. That's why the look of his films actually changed so drastically as you go through his career.
That's true.
Yes.
You know, Godzilla 54 was photographed by Mikio Naruse's primary cinematographer, and that's why it looks so strikingly different from all his other films. Mm-hmm. That's why the films from Mysterians up through King Kong Escapes, which were photographed by Hajime Koizumi, have this sort of universal look that we associate with Honda's classic films. And this film was done by a man named Taichi Konkula, who I think had photographed Honda's non-genre film, The Man Who Came to Port. I'm not 100% sure about that, but I think he did. And you can tell he has a very different sort of photographic style compared to, like, say, the films which came before. It's photographed in a much more different kind of way. Oh, this dub is wonderful. Don't get yourself so excited. Yes. I want all of you
to cooperate with us.
I love the pauses.
Yes. This dub is notoriously problematic.
Yeah.
That being said, his performance in the other true version, at least, is quite good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Although we should also mention about the really goofy looking outfits that Kubo and the rest of his crew had on.
Oh,
the
you
SY3.
Mean the banana suits?
Yes.
they look like gumdrop candies or something. It just doesn't scream 1999 to me.
No.
It's funny enough, when I was watching this film with my friends when we were younger, we're watching it well past the actual year 1999. In that opening prologue, they say, the year is 1999 AD. We've established an exploratory base on the moon. We're always like, wait, they did?
Well,
was that?
It's always weird to see movies that take place in the future like Back to the Future 2 is a perfect example.
Or going in with Honda's Spectrum, Gora, which takes place in 1980.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or, what was it? 2001 A Space Odyssey.
Mm. Yeah, perfect example.
You think Y2K is making all the kaiju go crazy? That was a big thing.
Maybe.
Yeah. Unless it was Y2J, Brayton.
No, Andrew.
No. I just want to imagine Chris Jericho, the kaiju killer.
No.
Don't ruin it for me.
We're about to meet the Kilox, I believe. Who, you know what? They're kind of uninteresting. In comparison, especially with the Exilians that we got in Monster Zero. That being said, you know, the intergalactic space nuns are... I appreciate how confident they are. And just how no-nonsense they are.
Yeah.
There's no elaborate scheme. There's no elaborate ploy to befriend... this is what a Barbra Streisand-esque shot that was. There's no elaborate ploy to trick the humans into thinking they're good guys. They're just saying, no, we're going to come down, we're going to control you, and that's how we're going to do things. So I respect that. I respect their, I don't know, confidence.
Andrew and I were talking about this a couple of days ago. They kind of remind me of the aliens from Signs in that they try to conquer a planet they're clearly not fit to inhabit.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because they can't survive on our temperatures, but they want to build a community here. Why? it's kind of like in Signs. Why would you go to conquer a planet that's covered in the one substance that you can't survive in? And in which sometimes has that substance coming down from the skies from storms.
Yeah. And I can assure you, they do not answer that question.
No, their glitter shower caps will protect them from Earth's
Although, we mentioned the Kilox because this is... it's funny that we mentioned up the Kilox now because this is also... I think the main problem I have with this movie and why I consider it among one of my least favorite entries... The entire vibe of the film I get is been there, done that. Not just even with the Godzilla franchise, but just knowing of other science fiction and, you know, action films that I've seen over the years. It doesn't feel anything fresh or even it doesn't really add anything. It's just kind of there.
You know, what you mean with the alien invasion aspect?
Not just that, but like also...
Because we would get that multiple times since this. But I think done better since this. When the aliens have a more... Maybe not necessarily a incredibly clear... clear motivation when it comes to other than we just want to take over this place. But they have more of a personality. They have more distinct, something that makes them distinct and from another world. And
the black hole aliens are much more interesting.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
And better dressed, I might add.
Yeah, and it's not even just like even them, but like even the human characters especially, like there's not nothing really that interesting about them. Acting is fine, but sure. Characters, I don't care about any single one of them. And hell, I'll give you another example. For a movie that I have complete disdain for, even Gaigen, I feel like looking back at that film has some potential for more interesting characters, like the main one being an artist, which I can kind of relate to, but then he gets roped into cockroaches from outer space.
And can like, you relate to that part, Andrew? Can you have you been roped in by cockroaches from outer space?
Well, I was I worked with a cockroach at one point, that's a story for a different day.
Did you just see her get like make her little exit by floating backwards?
Yeah.
Okay, but coming up here, we're going to see. I rewatched this recently in preparation for this commentary, and I forgot just how violent at points this film can be, and like really blunt some of the violence can be. A person coming up here, I'll make note of it when it happens, actually gets shot in the head. Mm-hmm. And yeah. I mean, that's something that we've never seen prior to this.
No, Mothra versus Godzilla.
Okay, that's true. Guy gets punched out and, yeah. Blood.
No, then he gets shot.
Does he get shot in the head?
Yes, he does.
Does he get shot in the head?
Yes, he does.
Does he comically go like cross-eyed when he gets shot in the head?
No, he does not.
Okay.
but he does get shot in the head. He uses the blood.
All right.
Yeah. Plus, yeah. Also with Kyoko, like her earrings getting ripped off, like, and you can see blood like actually pouring out a bit.
Okay.
I do have to say, I do think Destroy All Monsters has some of the better human level action than out of Honda's films. Because
There we go.
like the use of the set and like the pyrotechnics makes it a lot more exciting to watch than say like the car chase in the H-Man.
Sure. Yeah.
Or the final shootout in Atragon, the very one sided shootout in Atragon that doesn't make for a very exciting climax in that film.
Yeah.
I think this, for example, is a lot more energetic, a lot more beautifully photographed, and a lot more exciting and fun to look at than, like, say, the two things I just mentioned.
Yeah, totally.
What a day.
It's a shame Yoshio Tsuchiya gets offed so early on in this film, because...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's quite good in his brainwashed state. He's charming, but... Mm-hmm.
Although I must ask one question, though, as you mentioned this to me before, how do they get him undressed? Because like he went from a suit, and then he went from like all like with his like the wardrobe in the first part, and then all of a sudden it cuts like him in a suit. Like you were asking me about, like you were asking us that, like did they just like get him down and just dressed him?
Probably. He's very uncooperative. There's a shot coming up here in a minute too. That's always. It's funny when I think of this movie. It's strangely visually interesting because you like see through. It's a reverse shot. You see through. There it is right there.
Yeah.
He knows too much.
Oh, it's too much.
Out the window. Oh wait, no, not yet.
Yeah, they should have kept him in the film longer.
I agree. Yeah, he
Yoshio Tsuchiya makes everything better.
Absolutely. Yeah, I would have liked to have seen him go along with the Keylocks until maybe not till the end, but
yeah, he and Yukiko Kobayashi's character are the most interesting villains in the film.
Yeah.
And so, but he gets offed way too early, and she gets turned back to quote unquote normal way too early.
Mm-hmm.
To really like make anything interesting out of him. Here we go.
But no, it can be true.
3, 2, 1
Well. Hey, I'm all right. My dummy broke most of the fall.
Clearly, I will go falling no more.
You think he's okay? Now, contrast this gunfight we're about to see here with the one we just saw, and this doesn't hold up well. It's quite, I don't know. There's not a whole lot of cover, and it's not very convincing.
No.
that no one would get hit at all.
Sound effects too, like
they're literally using pew pew.
Yeah.
They're easily imitatable.
I think we should use these on him.
You into the kinky stuff?
We're the special police.
The special police.
Yeah.
What makes us special? We have no idea.
I don't know. Well, they're dressed. They're not even dressed especially well. So I don't. I have no idea. But pew.
Who do they represent?
Where do they come from? They're not from Interpol. At least that was a thing.
Maybe Interpol also calls themselves the special police.
I just we should take in this pew pew fight that we're seeing.
And if anything, there's one thing I've learned about Brett that I've learned over the past couple years. When describing stuff like this, when it comes to continuity and Showa films, to quote Brendan Tenold, Monsterland, try not to think about it too much.
See, the fact that no one gets hit. They're not special police if they can't hit anybody when there's no. They're just running. Look at this. They're goofballs. They're the Keystone Cops of the police.
And would you say they aim better than stormtroopers?
No. I'd say they're on the equal footing. They didn't hit anybody. Here's another kind of gruesome part too, where they slit open his neck. I mean. Ugh.
So that's where I found my wife's earring.
Yeah. We should probably mention the mind control devices in this film too.
Yeah.
I maybe you would know, Patrick, the actress's name.
Yukiko Kobayashi.
Yes. Is this her? I don't recognize her from anything before this.
She'd actually made her debut in another film of Honda's the year before, his last non-genre film called Come Marry Me,
okay.
When she appeared as a waitress. I think this was her first major role. I'd have to double check, but she was also later on in the first entry in Michio Yamamoto's Bloodthirsty trilogy. She played a vampire in that film. Mm. Very, very good too. Mm.
Yeah, her performance is.
She's good.
Yeah.
Yeah, she does a solid job.
And here we have Forrest Whitaker from Rogue One doing the the older man here.
Or Andrew Hughes, if you want to be specific.
Sorry, there you go. I just call people old.
He was an Australian businessman who moonlighted as an actor in many, 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 many films.
Yeah.
Not only in science fiction, but also in the films of Mikio Naruse. He was also in the sequel to. Jun Fukuda's Hunter Shot, Hunter Killed, and he played the Prime Minister of his own country in the original Submersion of Japan, among many, many other things.
Hmm. That's another example I was able to find out recently. He was also one of the scientists in the 1966 film Golden Bat, along with co-starring Sony Chiba, as well as a couple of others. It was kind of interesting to see him co-starring in that film. He played the he played the main scientist who got kidnapped by Dr. Nazo in order to get get a weapon which would destroy a meteorite in the film. Oh boy, this scene.
My cow made a ding noise. I don't know if something's wrong with it, but anyway, I passed the stone today. What do you think?
Ooh.
Cool.
I mean, this is just inexcusable. This voice acting. I'm sorry, but okay.
It can't be.
Now, even if your sight is awful, and you live in a world where these monsters, I think, would attack on a regular basis before they were put up in Monster Land, how could you confuse that for Rodan?
You got me.
I just don't know. I don't know.
Maybe it's like the giant claw where they think it's as big as a battleship.
He is big as... Maybe it's like the Plan 9 where they think the spaceships are cigar-shaped.
Ah.
I don't know. But no, yes, as we're experiencing now, and as we've mentioned, we spend a lot of time with this group of characters right here, and the only bit of monster action we've really gotten is the roll call at the start, and then the little clips of them attacking on the monitors. Yeah. Again, I would have liked to have seen a little more of that and a little less boardroom meetings. Oh, this is fun. The John Madden arrows. I want to know how they got the time to go to each of these things and conveniently place their mind control devices in a random coconut on a beach somewhere.
Yeah.
Oh, they're never going to find this.
Was it on Hawaii? Was it in a, like, just like on just a deserted island?
Well, you see, the Keylocks really have this thing planned out, Andrew.
And
again, it goes back to their confidence. I don't know. They just have the time to mess around with putting things in a coconut.
Oh, and also, I'm not sure if you noticed this, but like when they showed the map of where the where each of the mind control devices were, there were some of them that were just like flat out in the ocean.
Yeah.
Which, like, are they trying to control sharks or?
I don't understand.
I think it was on an island.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking too.
You're not doing a very good job of watching.
No.
Yeah.
She's right there.
She's right there, you idiots.
I found her.
Maybe it's just like Superman. Like, once she wears red, you don't recognize her.
If I'm not mistaken, though, we are approaching on... I just mentioned how the lack of kaiju action, but we're approaching on the big destruction scene coming up here.
Yep, we're getting there.
Yep.
I'll come back to the earrings later because there's a very surprisingly violent scene later on with a certain man ripping those out of her earlobes. It's quite frightening. Ah, here we go.
Yep, here's the big set piece. Or one of us should say.
Yeah. This whole sequence coming up really, I think, represents Toho's peak and what they can do with special effects.
Yeah, this is where the big budget came in handy.
Absolutely,
where,
yes.
Where a lot of it went. Seems like these are why Honda couldn't do like the undersea farming thing that he wanted to go more further out with, because a lot of it was going towards stuff like this.
Yeah, it's so elaborate and it's beautifully staged and the blocking is fantastic.
Yeah, and according to Steve Reifel, like some of these miniatures that we're working on, some of them were actually pretty small for them to work with.
Surprisingly so, because it's funny, this set does not feel small, it feels extremely expansive.
Yeah, like if you told me that this is a much, much smaller than it looks, I wouldn't believe you.
Yeah.
This is great.
Yes.
She isn't overly hammed up. She just like plays it like that nice little balance between, you know, underacting and overacting. Just makes it very, very good.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, a great reminder how much better Toho acting was in the golden era. You compare that to, like, say, the scientist in Destroyer, who wears the same blank face throughout the whole film. Yikes!
What? There he is.
Oh, I guess we should now, like, take the time to also talk about that this is probably the most... I guess you could say it's become now the signature Toho, like, Showa's Godzilla design.
Yeah. Really quickly, this shot right here, where that just happened, where Rodan built that building.
Mm.
People, like, watching with friends and family, they always say, how does Rodan destroy buildings by flying over them? then I'd have to explain to them that he's supposed to be flying super, super fast, but they just didn't film it very properly. In the original Rodan, it's a lot better done. Mm-hmm. The higher speed movement and camera movement goes a lot better in that film than here.
Yeah.
Oh.
But this is really cool, though.
Yeah.
This whole sequence is really cool.
There's Manda, everyone's favorite kaiju.
The insult to sock puppets everywhere.
Well, he serves his purpose.
He's much better here than he was in Atragon.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, we should also mention the great wire work here by Nakano.
Not Nakano.
Oh, he didn't work on this
Sadamasa Arakawa.
Oh, that was Arakawa? All right.
Yeah. Nakano would take over in 1971 with Hedera.
Okay.
See, there was a shot I didn't mention at the start, but... I actually saw Godzilla's Revenge before I saw this film, and if you remember the
stock footage.
The credit sequences, just a lot of stock footage from Destroy All Monsters, I was expecting to see that in the movie, but I was a little disappointed that I didn't get that.
I think I also saw Godzilla's Revenge before this too, so I think I had the exact same experience. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, what are you guys' opinion on the 1968 Godzilla suits?
I like it.
Yeah, a lot of people I've seen online have had a problem with it. You know, the neck being too long and the face being too wide.
Yeah.
I can see that, but it's fine to me, and it is iconic, and it's the standard hero Showa Godzilla design, I think.
Mm. I think it works. It works fine that Godzilla doesn't look too sinister, but it doesn't look too friendly at the same time.
Yeah,
it kind of strikes a nice balance for me.
Yeah, it's a happy balance between. They got it right here in the way that they got it wrong in the previous film, in my opinion, yeah. with Son of Godzilla.
Oh yeah.
By trying to make him yeah. look more friendly mm. and.
Now, the Son of Godzilla suit is just awful in every way.
Yeah,
well, yes.
Nothing about that works.
The only good shot of that one is from behind, when you don't have to look at it. Okay, now here's something I always questioned. Okay, you have giant monsters, you can clearly see them, and yet somehow you miss them.
Well, that's funny. Now, when I was a little kid, funny little story, when I was a kid watching this one time, my dad walked in during this sequence, and he said to me, and I can quote him verbatim, I now know why the Japanese lost the war. They hit everything but what they're aiming at.
Are we sure the Keyloks aren't controlling the military? Because they're destroying more of the city than the monsters are.
That's a good question.
And these are, these are automated missiles. So I don't know. Score one for monsters, or score one for the Keyloks, zero for the Japanese Self-Defense Force.
Yeah, you know there's a problem when so far you're making stormtroopers' aims look better. Yeah. Oh, we should also mention, like, probably up to that part where Mando was crawling, I believe that might have been the shot where there was a blooper for Destroy All Monsters where Mando was circling around a building, and then Godzilla went over and attacked him and got into a little tussle.
Oh, yeah.
So, and apparently the idea from what Rifle and Gajewski described was that it was that they, even though they're controlling the monsters, they don't have every bit of control over them.
Sure.
At least that was their personal
theory. Well, yeah, what they basically brought up was that they're assuming that the Keyloks, they're not controlling every single motion of the monster. They're just telling them where to go and just to do their thing. And
yeah.
All of the suit acting, the performances, and the characterization of the monsters is done really well.
Yeah.
They act like living creatures and react like living creatures. I'm just saying, man, destroy all buildings.
Yeah.
And it's very similar to the opening of, or to the scene in 54 where it's the panning shot. And this is all by the military, pretty much.
Yeah.
I mean, you gotta rethink who you're locking up on islands, is all I'm saying. Look into that.
The one thing I always found interesting about this movie is considering the person that they got to write this, because you would think that with a movie like this, they would have gotten Sekizawa, but instead they chose Kimura. Mm-hmm. And I'm kind of curious why they chose him to be the screenwriter for this.
Good question. Maybe, I don't know, maybe Sekizawa was occupied doing something else at the time, who knows?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's kind of apparent.
Maybe it's because they wanted to be more grim and serious.
Yeah.
Whereas Sekizawa's films are always very lighthearted and fun and have a lot of intentional humor to them, whereas Kimura's are more down to earth, more rooted in the loose bounds of reality as far as sci-fi goes.
Yeah, that's what I was about to mention. It's very much played straight, and there's hardly any moments of, maybe with the exception of the, hey, your son's all right, that's the only moment of levity, really.
That's the duh. You can't blame the Japanese filmmakers for that.
Yeah.
That's true. So, I can't even say that was a moment of levity then.
Yeah. Going back to your point, Patrick, a part of me likes to think that as well, that they probably chose him because they were trying to make a more serious film in this. But the problem is that with it being the final film in the series, and they're trying to be, as you could see, and this is not going to become the only one. There's a lot of action scenes in the movie. You'd think that they would have tried to, like, maybe bring in Sekizawa, who probably would have been a better fit to make, maybe not the story, you know, fully lighthearted or upbeat as he usually makes it, but maybe like a Mothra versus Godzilla type of way where it's upbeat, but it still has that dark tone to it.
Yeah. Well, the strange thing is that Kimura's, more often than not, the characters in his films are usually very interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But not so much here.
No.
Well, you know, then again, this is the point in his career where he's like, you know, just, he's doing sci-fi only because, you know, it's paycheck for him.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, and that's, and he's using his pseudonym Kaoru Mabuchi.
I was going to ask, had he started using that?
Yep.
By this point?
He'd already started using it by this point, yep.
Do you know when his, I don't know if he really had a huge passion for the genre to begin with, but do you know about the time when it started falling off?
It was like, the part where he started using his pseudonym was like in the mid-60s, so
okay.
Around the time of Baragon or Gargantua's.
Mm.
That's when he adopted his pseudonym, and the thing is that Kaoru can be, it's a name like Dana. It can be a boy's name and a girl's name in Japan, right. So that kind of adds to like the ambiguity of who Kaoru Mabuchi is.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, yeah, this scene is kind of...
It's so uncomfortable. It's,
yeah, it is.
He's just manhandling her, and everyone's watching.
Just rips her right out of her earlobe.
These are mine! She stole them from me! Arrest her. But, yeah, it is uncomfortable how he just kind of ragdolls her, and yeah. No one steps yeah. in. I don't know.
It's because he's the slapdash action hero, that's why.
It's true.
Let me yell at you more.
Yeah, unfortunately, this is the point where we lose our last interesting villain.
Yeah,
yeah. Right here. Really?
We gotta help her out. Maybe we should stitch up your ears. I'm sorry about that. I just got a little carried away. I felt so in charge.
We're approaching another good special effects set piece.
Sure.
Not a big one, but a modest sized one.
Yeah. And I feel like in this section too, and with the destruction sequence, I mentioned at the beginning, had just how great Ifukube's score is throughout.
Mm. Yeah.
It's very foreboding. It's very melancholy at points.
Mm-hmm.
I'd have to say of his marches in specific, this is probably my favorite military march that he's composed. You know, the Astro Monster is terrific, but this was the one that gets stuck in my head a lot.
Yeah,
I find myself humming occasionally.
Yeah, I argue maybe this may be like. Maybe the second most memorable march that he's done, next, of course, the original Godzilla theme, because any single time I've ever heard, like, any person, like, talk about, like, when it comes to the music, they always point to either the theme or this song in particular.
Yeah, well, I enjoy how each monster kind of, he incorporates each monster's sort of theme into the medleys that we saw in the destruction sequence when Rodan would fly over, you'd get Rodan's theme. When Godzilla surfaced, you got a little bit of his, and so it's nice, and that adds to just giving the monsters their own individual character and personality.
You know, one thing I never greatly appreciated about when it came to Sadamasa Arikawa is how good he really makes miniatures in this one.
Oh yeah,
yeah. Because there were times, especially that shot where the tanks were flowing through and you saw the helicopter like flying overhead.
Mm-hmm.
That was a really great shot.
Yeah, yeah. The miniatures in Son of Godzilla are really good too.
They are. Oh, and we also forgot to mention the arching breath that Godzilla is known for
the
this movie.
Breath. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well,
that pretty much started with Arakawa, really.
Yeah.
You saw that in Son of Godzilla 2 as well, when he shoots his breath at the mantis during when the last Kamakuras is kind of like trying to like pick on Minya, and then Godzilla pops up behind the hill and shoots his breath at his head.
Yeah.
The breath had a big noticeable curve in that one too.
I don't think it was a design choice. I think it was more of
I'm pretty sure it was a perspective.
Yeah, we didn't line this up right, so we gotta, you know,
make Nakano it. Nakano did the exact same thing in his films too.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
And even Kawakita in certain shots too in his films.
Yeah, this is really well shot. Godzilla for the first time in a long time looks really menacing.
Yeah.
Through the smoke and it's great.
Yeah, look at that.
Yeah.
Something look on his face too. That shot where he just looks like at first at a head on and then to a profile. It's really like got that mean look on his face.
Yeah.
Like it. Also, I'll just say it here again. Would you guys kindly aim for the monsters?
Well, no, there's actors inside there. They can't aim at them.
Oh, and
hey, I'm sorry, yeah. I'm late.
It's a great time to now mention this is also the debut of the signature Anguirus design.
Yeah, his reappearance since Raids Again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, where he got his neck broken.
Yeah, and it was really this one, and he became kind of a mainstay after this film, excluding the Heisei and the first half of the Millennium series. But the ones that came after this,
yeah,
really solidified him as one of the top top Godzilla allies, along with Rodan. And
I think Godzilla versus Gigan really cemented that more than anything. Yeah. That's what they were literally tag teaming against the enemy.
He took a blade to the face for him.
Yeah,
he did. With the staff member's hand visibly pushing
in the frame.
Well,
yeah.
Okay, maybe he didn't do it of his own volition. Maybe a staff person made him do it.
That's funny. When I was rewatching Godzilla vs. Gigan recently, I noticed that in that shot when Anguirus runs into Gigan's blade, for a split second, you can visibly see the staff member's hand holding the Anguirus cup by the head and pushing it in. And I've been watching that film for like almost 20 years. I've never noticed that, but now I'm never going to not notice that whenever I watch it again.
Yep. Here's a question I have for both of you. Out of all the films that you think were the huge underrated fan base appreciation for Anguirus has now, including ourselves, where do you think that really started? With this movie, Gigan, or Mechagodzilla?
I think it was Gigan.
Yeah, I'd say Gigan. I think, it's hard to say. I think he has... I don't know. I don't want to say that he plays a pivotal part in Gigan, but he has more of a proactive part there. He doesn't
more screen time.
Right. Honestly, he doesn't help much or do much in this film.
Yeah.
He shows up there. He gets his ass kicked later by Ghidra.
Yeah.
And I mean, he bites his neck at the end.
Yeah.
But that's about it. In Mechagodzilla, he gets his jaw broken. He's kind of a lovable wimp.
Which, fine enough, Mechagodzilla was the first film of his I ever saw, and I felt so bad for him when he got his jaw broken.
Oh, I felt awful.
Oh my god.
All the blood that comes out and the sound, the horrifying gurgling sound that he makes as he retreats in his hole to die. Oh.
Oh, Jesus.
This scene up here is pretty impressive in terms of combining the special effects with the live action stuff. Considering this is before the days of computers where you could manipulate everything, you know, digitally and match things up.
Sure.
Here you had to get everything right on the first take. The perspectives had to be shot exactly right.
Yeah, the same guy who would have done the same thing in Son of Godzilla, right? Because I remember the Son of Godzilla perspective work being really
Sadamasa Arakawa.
Yeah.
Yep. Even though Eiji Tsuburaya is credited for special effects from Sea Monster to Godzilla's Revenge, in actuality he was more of a supervisor. He would look over the footage, give it his approval and such, and he would have input and such, but he wasn't actually on the set directing.
Mm.
That was his longtime cameraman, Sadamasa Arakawa.
Okay.
And Arakawa did Sea Monster, Son of Godzilla, this, and he assisted Ishiro Honda as Honda directed the special effects in Godzilla's Revenge, the original special effects in that film.
Oh, okay.
When was it when he officially got credited as being the director of special effects?
I think it's this film. I'd have to double check. And of course, he also did Space Amoeba.
Mm-hmm.
Ah, yes.
Yeah, Arakawa is a... as many people have said, Arakawa's a main... area of expertise was his wireworks. You know, the wireworks for all the giant insects in Son of Godzilla.
Mm.
You know, Manda wrapping around the monorail in this film here.
Mm.
You know, everything involving King Ghidorah at the end, which is remarkably well done.
Yeah, with Son of Godzilla, all of Godzilla's foes are basically marionette puppets. Mm-hmm,
precisely.
And it's extremely convincing and pulled off extremely well. Mm-hmm. And I think that's, I may be blanking, but I think Ed or Steve brought this up. That might be a big reason why there weren't more monsters being proactively involved, minus the part where, you know, the suits aren't always in the greatest condition, so Baragon can't be in there. But, you know, Spiga or Kumonga, the reason he's just there to, I'll cover up the mess with his web at the end is because there's a lot of wire work going on just Ghidra alone.
Yeah,
Ghidra's got wires on his wings, his tails, all three of his necks.
Yeah.
Yep.
So that
you've got the wire work on the Godzilla and Gorosaurus's tail too, and Anguirus's.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Plus also Steve and Ed also mentioned that the monsters didn't really interact that much with the final fight because they wanted to just add monsters into the background to make it look larger.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Provide some background movement.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm. Yeah, I think this was the first time Arakawa got officially recognized in the credits as the director of special effects. Mm-hmm. And I think Tsuburaya just got acknowledged as supervisor, but I'm not 100% sure. I think he did get actual credit for this one. Mm. Yep, Arakawa had been Tsuburaya's cameraman for a long time. He was basically taught, as we learned from the panel, taught from the ground up in special effects. He didn't go to film school or like that. You know, he just joined the industry, got into special effects, and Tsuburaya basically taught him, along with everybody else. And they'd become very close because Tsuburaya was always a big fan of aviation, and Arakawa had been a fighter pilot during the war, so they bonded very much over their love for airplanes and such.
Huh. Which is ironic when you also considering the relationship that Eiji Tsuburaya had with the other people working on these films than versus Arakawa, where Tsuburaya, like, he was always there for, you know, whatever was going on with the special effects, but with Arakawa, he's like, "Yeah, let you guys do your job."
Yep, he told him what he wanted, and then he came back when they're all set to go, and then he directed the actual shooting.
Yep.
And it, but while they were setting up for who knows how many hours, he was outside, you know, playing baseball or something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Keyloks—they're just not interesting at all.
Nope.
I mean, they're not annoying or that, but they're just there. They're just kind of blah.
And I like the main actress. She's fine. But again, it's a persisting problem with the rest of the characters. Mm-hmm. The performances are, you know, stellar. They're very serviceable. Yep. But it's just they're not well defined characters.
No.
Yeah, I certainly don't think of these women when I think of, you know, great aliens in total science fiction.
This is the sorority that comes down.
Sorority girl.
Space feminists from the year 2000.
Yeah, the Mysterians, the Exilians, the Black Hole aliens, they're just far more interesting.
Yeah. I really like the narration. It reminds me, to go back to the beginning, I banged my head on the bed.
No.
This is your fault, Andrew. The narration is an interesting. It's not really explained in the way that something like a Raymond Burr narration would be, in that it's coming from someone within the film. It's kind of an omnipotent sort of deal.
Yeah, to be fair, that's always been like a thing with the 50s and the 60s where they would always have.
I like it.
Like, a lot of times it works in movies, and other times it can be a little bit annoying, like, say, the Giant Claw, where he's narrating over every single bit in the movie. Yeah. But this is one of those examples where I do think the narration fits fine.
Mm-hmm. I like the stuff at the beginning where, this is Monsterland, and all of them are thriving here. And it feels like a, sort of like something you'd see on Nat Geo or something.
Yeah.
Where it's like, oh, look at this research center. It's really well done. Are we getting to the very long sequence of
infiltration scenes?
Yeah. Let's see. This is the part of the film where, you know, go up, use the restroom, maybe
The making of story behind this sequence is actually pretty interesting.
Oh, okay.
The XY3 model was very, very large, and they needed it to fit into this big crater where the like this where the set the crater for the set where the Keyleth base is. But when art director Yasuyuki Inoue, one of the unsung heroes of this genre, you know, he realized, you know, we had either build the set very high off the ground, in which case we couldn't show very much of the top backdrop of the sky. So the other alternative, but he didn't want to do that, so with the size of the model and how big it was.
Sure.
So the other option was to dig a big hole in the studio floor. And the studio floor is made of concrete. And the funny thing, and Inoue knew from the start the studio would never give him permission to do that if he asked. So he just did it anyway.
Oh. It's better to ask for forgiveness than to ask for permission.
Well, here's the hilarious part. You know, when the studio, of course, eventually found out that they had a big, huge hole in their floor. And so they came to him and said, you know, why did you build a hole in the floor? Oh, I got permission. Well, who'd you get permission from? And he said, I got permission from me. Again, one of the unsung heroes of this genre. Mm. Yep, he was AD Supervia's art director for many, many, many years. Mm. And he was a big contributor in the special effects for these films.
Can't imagine what that would be like for a morning for an executive. They just walk in with coffee in hand, and they just look down. It's like
fall
it's
on the
like,
floor. Yeah. Fall in the hole in the floor.
Not even just that, but
I'm
like,
stuck in the hole in the floor.
Yes. Or it's like they're just walking around, like, oh, hey Honda, hey Subaru, oh, hi giant hole in the ground. Wait, what?
Yeah, they're like one of the one bank robber from Revenge. I fell through the hole in the floor.
Yeah.
What are you doing down there?
Maybe that's where they got the inspiration for that scene.
Maybe. Oh. You know, I'm sure Pearl Jam's Dark Side of the Moon would go great with this sequence. Hello.
Man, I just love that story because it really shows, you know, how much of a bold person Yasuki Inoue was. Mm-hmm. You know, he realized that doing that would really benefit, you know, the production and such. And he just did it without permission from anybody. Just did it anyway.
Sure.
Oh, they sound so scared. such a glorious dub.
Well, I mean, they just battled two giant radioactive monsters. Yeah. They're probably used to anything at this point.
Oh, yeah, they're just fighting flamethrowers now, right?
Sure.
Yeah. I mean, it's not like typical. The thing could blow them up or anything. Nope.
We're safe inside here, inside the SY-3.
Yes.
Ifukube's music really works here.
Oh, it's incredible.
And it was also used in the when the SY-3 crew was fighting the bad guys at the base on Monsterland.
Yeah.
It worked really well there too.
Yeah, Ifukube is really good at, there, you know, it could come across to someone else who is maybe less experienced or intelligible about doing it, when a composer reuses their work out of laziness. Mm-hmm. But he really knows when to reuse tracks to fit the mood of the scene and to do it in a smart way.
He's good enough that he can get away with it.
Sure.
I mean, I do think it's a fair criticism to cite his repetition in his films.
Yeah.
But I do think that he was good enough and intelligent enough and in the way he did it that he could get away with it.
Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know if it's a reuse thing, but I think at least at times you get at least a hint of kind of a Terror of Mechagodzilla vibe with this kind of music in particular. The sort of, it's like the Titanosaurus theme almost.
Yeah, like the actual composition itself feels kind of similar.
Yeah, it's dark, very dark and moody.
Yes, and actually going back to your point, Patrick, what you said about like with the repetition of the score, it's never been an issue that really bothered me, except for certain degrees when sometimes I could be saying maybe a little bit less on the Godzilla theme being used, like in Terror of Mechagodzilla, where that's used a lot in that film. Mm. Sometimes it isn't bad, but just other times I just kind of wish something else would be playing over, you know?
It's not like they just snuck into the Toho archives and literally just plucked the recording out, like another example.
Oh, yeah, like a certain movie that came out in 2016.
Oh.
Oh. when they also had the opportunity to recompose that by Ifukube's apprentice, since they had a live concert of him doing it, but nope.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're referring to Kaoru Wada, who did a live cinema re-recording of the Godzilla 54 soundtrack, which is amazing.
Mm-hmm.
And sounds very good done with modern day technology.
Yeah, I would respect something a lot like that a lot more if they took the time to recreate that. Same with the 54 roar, you know, if they meticulously tried to recreate the roar using the same techniques and everything, but did it in a new with a new recording quality where it's still not that great. It's got a lot of grain to it because you can tell that it was taken directly from the original.
From years ago, so it'd be interesting to see somebody try to experiment and try to bring that roar to life with modern technology.
Yeah.
The point that I'm trying to get across here is hashtag put Wada in there.
Put Wada in there?
Yeah, let's put Wada in there.
Okay. Wada guy.
Wada guy.
No, yes, I think we're coming up though on the bathroom break scene when they go to the with the flame, the little torch and the the flight of the kind of sounds like the flight of the bum. What is it? The flight of the bumblebee.
Actually, I think that's a little bit later. I think this is when the scene we first discover that the Kilox have another form, which
oh, is that right? Oh, yes, it is. Okay.
Yeah.
This is where we establish the point of, why did you want to make a scientific community on this planet, of all planets?
Yeah.
Which, here's something I always wondered. Is the original form the Kilox just worms? Or, because the way they show in the movie is the worms going into rocks, but then the rocks, like they're part of it. So does that mean that it's part of their system? Like, they didn't really explain that part. I think that... Kind of wish they would have went...
Well, to quote Andres, here's the answer. Yes!
Yes!
Always!
No, we don't get anything concrete like in Gaigan, where we have a dying cockroach on fire talking.
Yeah.
No! No!
It's done so well!
Ugh. It's beauty on the inside. It's kind of... Yeah, I think it speaks to the confident ignorance that the Kilox have. Mm-hmm. When we go later on in the film, they're still confident about, oh, we've got Ghidorah. And then when Ghidorah fails miserably, it's like, oh shit. Oh, I mean, well, we've got the Fire Dragon, and I mean that fails even harder. I don't know. They It seems like they came with a plan in mind, and they just didn't really think about everything else around conquer Earth, take over monsters.
Yep. Of course.
Of course. And it makes me appreciate people. It makes me appreciate species and characters like the Exilians more because of their craftiness.
Yeah, they at least had a plan, you know, throughout the film that... shows that they were at least willing to try to go to different means as to take over the Earth.
Yeah, it was well.
This had a motive.
It was well calculated too.
At least they had a reason for attack, which made them interesting.
Yeah.
And you had the whole thing of, you know, the one who falls in love with a person.
Mm, yes.
That makes
yes.
Sense. That also makes it interesting, but here, you know, they're just dumb.
Yeah, it's very standard. We're aliens. We're bad. We like Earth.
And we didn't think this through.
No.
We went too far in a few places.
Yep.
Yes.
Yeah, here we go.
Yes, the sequence.
This is everybody check their watch.
Oh, wait. It's funny that the subtitles say screwdriver when he's saying power.
That's something you see a lot. We're watching this, our copy of the film with the volume low and the subtitles on. And that's something you notice a lot with dubbed versions of these films.
Yeah, we're watching a dub, but with subtitles on.
Yes.
Yeah.
So we're trying to get the best of both worlds.
The problem is that And the thing is with the subtitles, Brayton, this was your idea because you make sure since the volume might be too low enough to, for us to hear, we might as well just have subtitles. The problem is, I think they chose the Japanese subtitles as opposed to the...
Well, yeah, of course.
Yeah, so...
It's quite interesting seeing the difference.
And it's up, and these guys always think it's a good idea to watch these films dubbed for whatever reason.
Well, yeah.
for comedy purposes, yes. Patrick.
Well, to be fair, with last year, we pretty much did that against your will, but yes. This time you made the decision to do so.
Oh, yeah, because of a moment that's coming up later on in the film, which we'll point out. Now, I do think this sequence is actually pretty interestingly edited.
Oh, yeah.
The way it's put together and shot. Now, how well does it fit in the narrative? Not all that well. It could have easily been cut.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, as far as a piece of filmmaking, it's pretty interesting, I think, especially as it goes along.
Sure. It goes on for quite a while, and the editing tries to splice things up and make it more...
Yeah.
Seem more action-packed. Mm-hmm. Not action-packed, but more...
visually interesting.
Yeah, fast-paced and interesting than just them shooting mm-hmm. a laser at a thing. Yeah.
I also kind of like the tension of them trying to take down the mind control device that basically controls all the monsters here, and the wire is slowly getting on fire because it's too much for it to handle. Although in the end, like, I kind of felt like they didn't take advantage of that more, but it was just for one cool suspense scene, so mm-hmm. it still works, even though it does go on for a little too long.
Hey, this is very good. Very good editing.
Yeah, it creates a sense of urgency.
I mean, is it dramatically compelling in terms of these characters? No. But as a piece of visual filmmaking, I think it's very impressive.
Yeah, it's better than just having a static shot of them shooting at the thing. You know, it's funny enough, when I first got my... laptop, and my mom warned me about don't leave it plugged in or else it's gonna overheat.
Oh, yeah.
I envisioned like the cord, my charger lighting up the same way.
Film.
Yes. Yeah. With the music playing, dun da 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 da.
You're running to try to unplug it as the thing's going on fire.
Boom.
I am.
Ooh.
Nice explosion.
I give Kawakita some shit occasionally for his sparks, but you know they're pretty, and the sparks here are pretty.
Mm.
Put sparks in there.
You're so alive! Oh my god!
We are alive!
Save the rebellion! Save the dream!
That's amazing.
It is. There's just such interesting. I'm a defender of dubs, but there in this film in particular, and some of the worst cases, you know, the worst offenders being the later Showa films. You have to wonder, as voice actors, I'm guessing it's the same guy doing a lot of these voices, and he's trying to make it sound like different people, obviously. But the acting choices are just astonishing when it comes to just how out there.
Some of the dialogue in the dub is pretty strange too. Like, you know, Doctor, why didn't the monsters attack Tokyo? I want to know that myself.
Mm-hmm.
No, excuse me, I'm tired.
We're all very tired. Oh, it's the same shot again.
Yeah.
The movie's starting over.
Now we're more than two thirds of the way through the film.
That's right.
Yeah.
You know, that's something I was just speaking for myself. I think this film actually, you know, makes up somewhat for its thin characterization by just moving along very, very fast.
Mm-hmm.
You know, even though there is a lot of dry human quote unquote drama, you know, it moves fast enough to the point where I don't mind that much.
Yeah.
And it hasn't felt all that too terribly long for me watching it so far. And we're almost to the big money scene.
We are. We're getting there right now. Yeah. This is like I love this. This reminds me of the sort of like the Macy's Thanksgiving parade.
Yeah.
And now the Rodin float. It's pretty fun.
Yeah, and for this scene, they filmed it in an especially large soundstage that had a very high ceiling, so they could build really tall matte paintings like that. The sky, the Mount Fuji, that's all a big matte painting. Mm-hmm. And they wanted to have that real sense of scale, so they had really high ceilings for the soundstage in which they shot it.
Oh, no. Speaking of which, Patrick, would you mind going into details for people about that giant Mount Fuji painting for everyone?
What about it?
Who painted it?
Unfortunately, I can't remember the man's name, unfortunately. It's a Steve. If you can find the audio commentary with Steve Reif and Gajewski, they talk about it in depth there. But unfortunately, I cannot remember the man's name off the top of my head.
All right.
It is really impressive and really well done, though.
Yeah.
Oh, I should mention about one part about here with another part of the dub.
Yeah.
Was I could see Angeles. Angeles is alone. Several memes came out of that.
Yeah. Oh, there's Varon making
his camera.
I'm helping.
Oh, by the way, we'll get to it later, but man, does this Rodan suit look terrible.
Oh, God.
He gets smashed in the face with a frying pan.
Apparently.
Yeah.
And we'll see the real bitter pill as we get further on into the fight.
Well, now, is it worse than the Ghidorah suit?
Yes.
Those at least had some charm to them. Yeah. This thing is just embarrassing.
From a distance, if you squint, it's fine. Yeah. But like when you get into the close-ups, it's a little off.
No, it gets two close-ups during the final battle, and they're both shots you could easily have cut out without losing anything. It's just embarrassing.
Any stock footage?
Yes. Well, you know, it looked so good the first time. We got to keep reusing it. How else are we going to introduce him?
Yeah.
That's the reason why I've never given Terry Shinakno flack for stock footage, because everybody's done it in this genre.
Yeah.
Tsuburaya did it, Arakawa did it, Kawakita did it. You know, it's just it's kind of like a given thing with these films. I've just grown to accept it.
Mm-hmm. It depends on, for me, it depends like how much they use it. Like in stuff like this where they're far less, that's one thing, but if it's something like, say, I don't know, like, say, Gigan, where the majority of it, the monster action is stock footage, that's when it gets a little bit questionable. That's when it tests my patience. That's just my point of view, anyway.
Yeah.
Oh, this is fantastic when Ghidorah lands.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yep, Ed Gajewski always talks about how this is, like, one of the big money shots he always remembers from having seen this film as a kid. And you can definitely see why. This shot right here where Ghidorah lands. The suit actor lands perfectly, all the smoke flies up at just the right time, Godzilla and their monsters react just perfectly.
Mm-hmm.
It's brilliantly done.
Yes.
Beautifully done.
Now, I have to ask you guys, did you ever feel that Ghidorah stood a chance in this?
No.
Okay, this, again, speaking to the Kilok's incompetence. Yeah.
Yes.
He got his ass handed to him by Mothra, Rodan, and Godzilla. Then just Godzilla and Rodan. Yeah. Now there's like nine of them.
Yeah.
You should have said Ghidorah and the Fire Dragon at the same time, at least to make it somewhat fair.
Yeah. Yeah, so maybe out of sympathy, like that's why Varan and Barragan are hanging back. Just give him a fighting chance.
Oh, no.
My God. Oh,
so terrible. Rodan's never looked worse.
Ugh.
Never looked worse.
That he's drunk. He's Don Fry levels of drunk. He's just bobbing around.
Oh, yeah. Horrible!
No,
you could have cut both those shots out.
Yeah, you know. Again, I appreciate a lot of this, and a lot of this is cool, but I wish. This whole scene is iconic. Yeah. I wish they would have given Ghidorah more of a fighting chance to make him seem more of a formidable threat in this, at least.
Well,
because he has this is like his only offense, really.
Yeah, right here, like he feels things with his teeth, right there.
Well, yeah, he drops him down and he steps on him. But after that, after Gorosaurus drop kicks him, it's all over.
Yeah. Hey, you could say Gorosaurus was the hero in this movie because of that dropkick.
Maybe. It's a pretty good dropkick. There's their base.
Yeah, watching this scene for the first time when I was very, very young, this scene, you know, the scene where he, like, pounces down on Angus and hear all the crunching sounds.
Yeah.
When I first saw it, I thought he was breaking his back and killing him.
That's pretty
good. And it really bothered me, especially since I watched this with my sister for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
My sister's not really a Godzilla fan, but she likes Angus.
Yeah.
And when we thought Angus had died, she was like, oh no. I thought he just got killed. I thought he just broke his neck. But then thankfully, couple shots later, he lifts his head up again and keeps walking. Okay, good, he's still alive.
Yeah, we feel a lot of sympathy in these movies for Anguirus because he gets his butt kicked a lot, you know? Yeah. We when this stuff happens to him, we feel that just an extra bit of sad sorrow.
Maybe he's got something in his contract where even though he has to get something where he gets his ass whooped, they at least try to give him some bit of sympathy.
Yeah. Yeah. But yeah, I would have liked it if we had more of those moments, even with Godzilla and Gorosaurus, where Ghidorah's, you know, being an actual threat rather than just sort of standing in a single place. And I understand, you know, the wire work and everything, with the madness that goes on there, but...
That's really good, too.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's certainly not at Gigant levels of stiffness.
No.
The Ghidorah suit is very mobile.
It's very well animated in terms not literally animated, but animated in terms of the way it's moved around.
Mm-hmm.
One thing I always notice about with these Godzilla films when King Ghidorah is usually involved is Godzilla has this thing where King Ghidorah flies in the air and he always grabs the legs.
Yeah.
Like, that seems, I noticed that's a tradition with him in each of these films.
Mm-hmm. Oh. It happened in the 91. Oh, there we are.
Yep, that's
it.
The drop kick.
That's it. That's all she wrote. It's all. I feel bad for Ghidorah.
I do too.
Yeah, same here.
I was surprised they actually went out and killed him in this one.
Yeah, this is so violent. It's like gang violence here.
Yeah.
The sound he makes and the blood that spurts out.
Yeah, but this time I'd already seen the 91 King Ghidorah, and I'd seen Monster Zero before this. And I think I'd seen Ghidorah the Three-Headed Monster too, which, not counting the 91 film, Ghidorah always flew away and survived at the end. And,
here
they stomp him to death. It's really brutal.
I don't think they anticipated having to reuse the suit after this.
Of course not.
Just beat the fuck out of it.
Okay, now this scene coming up, this scene is bullshit.
Oh, well, you know. Minya's pretty lame. Give him something. He jumped on a seesaw in Revenge. That's his only other moment of greatness.
Oh, Ghidorah. Okay, at least give him a proper burial.
No, that's one of the best fights in the Godzilla series.
Oh yeah.
It's amazingly well done.
Mm-hmm. So it's one of the greatest beatdowns, we should say.
Yes.
Oh, man. Yeah, all of this is great. The little moment of triumph here.
Yeah, the suit acting is very good.
Mm-hmm.
Puppetry.
I helped. I was there. Yeah, I was there. Yeah. The manga, 1968.
He's like NBC's Brian Wins, but he was actually there.
He was actually there.
But he did just as much. This is so disappointing to me when it turned out just to be a UFO.
Yeah, the double climax, yeah.
Yeah, the bait and switch.
A burning monster is on its way.
Yeah, and we're approaching the part which has remained the source for a long-standing joke in my family. Ever since I was a little kid, we're getting very close to it.
And there's a...
Oh, hold on.
Not yet.
No.
It's only the dubbed version, of course.
No, I love that quote, too, though. A burning monster? I've never heard of one.
Yeah,
wait.
What are these burning monsters?
Right, here we are.
Wait.
Okay.
What? Well, wait for it.
Silence. There it is!
How heroic.
Quick, hide!
When all else fails, hide! Run!
The monster's coming to us! Quick, hide!
Hide!
And insert sad Brachiosaurus. It was all a lie!
Rip in peace, Brachio.
Yeah. All their research. I want to know what's so that's Monster Land, correct?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. How did they just repair it like the rest of Tokyo?
Yeah, they rebuilt Tokyo and alarmed.
That's true. Why am I questioning? Oh, look, see how smug she still is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But there's a great moment coming up here though, where you see a total shift in her attitude, which I like.
Yeah.
It's the one moment of self doubt. We hide. Oh, I love it.
Yes.
That's at this moment the Keelock knew. No, I love that. That's just a subtle little performance on their part.
Yeah. Oh, no.
I like the editing in this scene here, too. Like the way it montages between Godzilla shooting his breath, hitting the dome, back to Godzilla, and then back again. Like there, right there.
Yep.
It's a very interestingly edited film.
It also kind of shows like what kind of adaptable fighter Godzilla's become, because he realizes when the flame doesn't work, there's always use your fists.
He doesn't just keep spamming his breath like in the Heisei series.
Right.
Or in a... or in Shin Godzilla.
Oh, Andrew. He doesn't spam... well... he doesn't spam his breath, he spams his lasers.
he spams his breath after he gets tired of strolling around like a poorly animated wind-up toy.
Yeah, because, I mean, after all, that's the only other thing he does is walk.
Yeah, and stand still for interminable periods of time.
Oh, they're gonna hate me for this. And therefore, Ghidorah has become one with the earth here in a moment.
Yep.
Sure enough. Yeah, you know, that's another thing. They never explain how he returns, but I mean, I don't care. He's great. It's nice to see him whenever he does.
Well, there was a popular theory that most fans have used that, and since this took place in 1999, the films that came afterwards would be set in the modern day.
Yeah, I don't think this film gives one iota about continuity, though.
No. But most of the Godzilla films don't.
No, it's fun. No. It's fun. They started out when they were connecting things, trying to have it be a little cohesive.
Yeah.
But after a while. Just to hell with it. No one cares enough to, you know, make a big stink about it.
Yeah, but it's not like it's going to fix anything great, but at least it's a simple enough explanation to explain where this one connects with everything else.
Yeah, yeah. The fire dragon.
Yeah.
Ten years since I first saw this and I'm still disappointed. I was like, ooh, another kaiju battle? Yeah. Maybe this one will stand a chance. Well. And therefore, the Moonlight SY3 was a complete failure, and Tokyo was burnt to the ground. I think the fire dragon's related to the firebird.
Given that it's a saucer, no.
Well, I'm just saying in name only, maybe.
How so?
What a dick move by the fire dragon. Yeah. They won't notice me up here.
It's a nice, comfortable ship.
I love the sound effects. It's kind of like Godzilla vs. Gigan when Gigan and King Ghidorah first appear and they do that somersault in the air.
Woo! Okay. That I don't remember.
Oh, I do.
Here.
So them giving them the whole line about the fire dragon was just a cover-up story.
Yeah.
It was just a total BS.
Yeah. All right.
Fire.
And now it's become the ice dragon.
One shot and it's down.
Boom.
Well, technically they had hit it before.
Yeah, well,
and then just pulled away and turned off its flames and exposed itself for an easy shot. Yeah, it's a serviceable double climax, but it's not as good as what came before it.
No.
You know, the Ghidorah fight is the most exciting sequence.
That's the climax, and then this is kind of just you know.
Yeah. It's a double climax.
Extra fluff, yeah.
Yep. It's entertaining enough, but you know, the peak of the momentum is in the Ghidorah fight.
Yeah, it'd be nice if the roles were reversed and they were like, oh, the fire dragon, and they took that out easily and then coming with the Ghidorah stuff.
All right, we're very close to the end of the film now.
We are. It's been a breeze. Well, guys, I guess as we're kind of closing up here with this last flyover, Destroy All Monsters, 50 years later, what are your thoughts?
No different than when I last saw it. But I do appreciate it, I guess, a little bit more so since I last saw it, given Rifle and Gajewski's panel. But not much has changed.
Still the same as always, you know. I like it a good deal. It's a lot of fun. I think it's got a lot of scripting issues, but it's well made enough and it's fast paced enough where I don't mind it that much. I find it to be a fun, enjoyable kaiju flick. It's not even remotely one of my favorites. It's not up there with my all time favorites, but it's an enjoyable film that I'll watch every now and then, I would say.
Yeah, it's not an all time favorite for me. It's oh, there's Varan.
Oh God.
Hi, just reminding you I was here.
Yeah.
I'm in the credits. No, but it's middle of the road, but in my ranking, but I certainly do appreciate the legacy that it has.
Mm-hmm.
This being the first. The grand finale, as it was maybe intended at the time to be.
Yeah.
It just has some balancing issues, but the effects, the monsters, all Toho at their absolute peak, doing what they do best.
Yeah. It's from space, and it's alive!
Doctor, it's coming closer to us! Quick, hide!